Okay, good morning, everyone, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this side event on how can satellite improve forest monitoring and management. So my name is Yasuko Inoue, working for Kenya for a technical cooperation project between forestry of Ministry of Forestry and Environment of Kenya and JICA and Kenya Forestry Services. And Kenya Forestry Institute. So thank you for coming today. We are very happy to see you all. And so this event is co-hosted by Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, JAXA, Ministry of Environment and Forestry of Kenya, and Japan International Cooperation Agency, JICA. The objective of this event is to highlight and show the importance of the satellite technical advancements in forest carbon monitoring systems and related policy measures to tap into the carbon markets while achieving NDCs to contribute to the global target of climate change mitigation. Before starting, I would like to inform you that this event will be recorded and to be published by YouTube. Please stay in touch with the Twitters of JAXA and JICA to get the further information. Thank you. So first of all, I would like to introduce Professor Julius Tanui. He is the CEO of Kenya Water Tower Agency. He will deliver on behalf of Mr. Engineer Festus Ungeo, Principal Secretary of Ministry of Forestry, Environment and Forestry of Kenya. So, Mr. Tanui, you have a floor. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Professor Julius Tanui. I'm the Director General of Kenya Water Towers Agency, representing the PS Engineer Festus Ngeno on behalf of the government of Kenya. So, Karibu, Jambo. I have a statement from the PS. I will allow me to read it. How can satellite improve forest monitoring and management? I think I want to thank Japan because we've collaborated for a very long time in this field of forest monitoring and management, I think over a period of 30 years. How can satellite improve forest monitoring management? Organized collaboratively with JICA and government of Kenya. The government of Kenya acknowledges the long-standing cooperation and technical support of Japan International Cooperation Agency, JICA, in forest sector spanning over a period of 37 years. Through the technical support by JICA, we have developed the National Forest Monitoring System, NFMS, Forest Information Platform, FIP, and Forest Reference Level, FRL, as an essential tools of monitoring forest management status. This event has been convened to highlight and show the importance of the satellite technical advancement in forest carbon monitoring, as well as development of appropriate policy measures to tap into the carbon markets while implementing nationally determined contribution NDC. It will show how Earth observation satellites contribute to improve forest monitoring and management, as well as nature-based solutions for climate change mitigation and adaptation in Africa and around the world. Kenya will have an opportunity to demonstrate our enhanced capacity to accurately monitor and report our forest status to the world. It is an assurance to our partners of our resolve as a government to put in place the necessary infrastructure to transparently track performance of forest and landscape restoration efforts, and which is an essential element in attracting financing at a scale from both public and private sources for forestry development. It also serves to demonstrate to the world the results of North-South and South-South collaboration and partnership in the implementation of actions to deliver global values. This is important in COP27, that is also referred to as implementation of COP. A national forest monitoring system is an important element at the WASO framework of Red Plus activities, and we have agreed that Kenyan system should be capable of to measure and report on tree cover changes. This is informed by the fact that our policies are both forest and tree cover goals. The technologies we are showcasing today have immediate application in Kenya. Other than Red Plus process, the system will report on our performance at the national level with regard to global and national forestry commitments that we have subscribed. These include AFR 100, land degradation neutrality, biodiversity restoration, and the classical leaders commitments. These commitments will be achieved through the ambitious large-scale forest and rangeland restoration initiative that the government has initiated. I am aware the technologies we are showcasing and that we seek to deploy to monitor our forest and science driven. Their wide application will require strong financial and technical support, political goodwill, strategic partnership, and collaborations. We, however, take comfort of the existence of global partners willing to partner with us. We are particularly grateful to the government of Japan and Japanese institutions and companies, including JAXA, who have offered invaluable support in this area. We seek their continued and scale-up engagement and investments to enable implementation of climate action at scale for the benefit of the global and local communities. As we think global, let us support local actions that deliver global benefits. It is my sincere hope that the exchange and network, good practice information about NFMS FIB shared amongst us will serve mankind and serve to catalyze investment for climate action. I thank you for the opportunity to address you in this monitoring. Thank you very much. That is the end of the remarks from the CS. Appears environment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Tanui. It was a very great opening remarks. So we JICA thank you to Kenya for very long standing cooperations and under the equal partnership and so great collaborations together. So next, I would like to introduce Dr. Hiroshi Suto, who is delivering the keynote presentation for this event. So, Dr. Suto, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm Hiroshi Suto from JAXA. So today, I'd like to introduce our JAXA's activity for monitoring, forest monitoring and management. So here, the JAXA, JAXA is a space agency and operating the Earth observation satellite. The type is, we have several types of the Earth observation sensors. So, for focusing on the forest and the forest management, we are providing forest and non-forest data from the AROS-2. And also the regarding the forest activity, and now our GOSAT and GOSAT-2 can provide the forest activity information. It means that the photosynthesis activity information via this satellite. Then Now we are analyzing with couple these two satellite data. Today, I'd like to present and introduce our latest technology for detecting the forest monitoring and also the how to improve the forest management using the satellite data sets. At first, I would like to introduce the JAXA greenhouse gas observation sensor. So now we are operating the two GHG sensor. One is the GOSAT, the other one is the GOSAT 2. For GOSAT, we already task 13 years on orbit, and this data is freely available via the website. So both GOSAT and GOSAT 2 can have a capability to observing the grid and the targeting for the interesting location. Especially for the targeting observation, it's a very powerful tool to identify or observing the cities or some interesting area, because we can manage the intense observation over these interesting regions. Now, our JAXA newly developed a state of art retrieval algorithm. It means that deriving the near surface silt concentration using the GOSAT and the GOSAT 2 data. The conventional satellite observation just providing the total carbon of the CO2. It means that a little sensitive to near the surface CO2 emissions. However, if we apply the new data set, the new partial carbon data deriving by the GOSAT and the GOSAT 2, it's a more highly sensitive to near the surface CO2 changes. So like these panels. The light one showing the image for the comparison between the conventional and the newly developed partial carbon concentration data. As you can see, over the Tokyo megacity area, the spatial pattern for the CO2 concentration is clearly observed by the new partial carbon density products. Also, our GOSAT and GOSAT 2 can provide the solar induced fluorescence signals. It's directly related to the photosynthesis of the forest or vegetation areas. Here is some regional comparison data set. As you can see, the 10 region in this map, I pick up the 10 region, including the Africa and the European or Amazonia. So as you can see, the sea intensity is indicating the CO2 removal, because if the sea signal is high, the CO2 concentration is low in the all the areas. Then we are now considering the this sea signal as a CO2 removal markers. And also we are now analyzing with comparison with combined with the AROS forest non-forest map dataset. For the demonstration over the Cairo, the Cairo is also the mega city. During the winter season, the Cairo is emitting a lot of the CO2, but in the summer season, the vegetation of forest is very active. Then, top panel is showing the CO2 concentration over the Cairo, and also the in the light panel showing the solar-induced fluorescence signal intensity. The green one is the more intense the vegetation, solar-induced fluorescence. In Cairo, they're still emitting the CO2, but the surrounding area, so like farmland or forest area, capturing the emitted CO2 from the Cairo during the summer season. In other words, it's a growing season of the vegetation or forest. But in the winter season, the CIF is not so active. Then the Cairo CO2 is still positive, enhanced. So next one is the AROS. AROS is directly detecting the forestry area by using the LiDAR technique. Here is the forestry map. Green one is the forest. Yellow one is a non-forest area. To comparing the different year or different time series data set, we can identify the deforestation area like the red indicator. Using this data, we can managing the forest area or non-forest area. So now our JAXA providing the JJ FAST, providing with the JICA. So this is the forest changes map, and this can providing the this system can providing the forest change map every 45 days. This data is used in the 78 countries now, and we are expanding this technique in the other region. So today I just talking about two satellites or data set, but to combining in the future this combining the CO2 concentration, CO2 change data, and also the forest change data is very important. So if you are interested in our data sets, please contact us, and also the, we can collaborating to analyzing this data set. Okay, thanks so much. That's all I have.
Thank you very much, Dr. Suto. Very interesting presentations. So I would like to now start the panel discussions. Please, Mr. Peter Ndiwati, he is the Deputy Chief Director, Deputy Chief Conservator of Forest, Kenya Forest Services. So he is going to facilitate the panels. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name, as you have said, is Peter Ndwati. I work for Kenya Forest Service, Deputy Chief Conservator of Forests, and also coordinating a JICA project that has been a recipient of SIT rights. And this time, we'd want to have some presentations to showcase how SIT rights have been utilized and how the products have been. And I think we would want to start off by inviting Alfred Gishu, who is going to be our first presenter. He is the Forest Conservation Secretary, Ministry of Environment and Forestry, back in our country, Kenya. Welcome.
Good morning again. I head the Forest Conservation Directorate at the Ministry of Environment and Forestry, and also coordinate the National Red Plus process. And I have the pleasure this morning to share with you the journey we have traveled in support of our National Red Plus process and where we are heading to moving forward. And the journey that we have traveled and where we are moving is informed strongly by global policies that are emerging from UNFCCC. And we are aware that the developing tropical countries that wish to participate in Red Plus as a mechanism must invest in four basic elements, one of which is a national forest monitoring system, a forest reference level, a national strategy, and a safeguard information system. And those four elements form what is referred to as the WASO framework of lead plus elements. I want to report to you that as I speak here with you, we already have for Kenya a national strategy for lead plus implementation that has been delivered with the financial and technical support from the Forest Carbon Partnership Facility and the United Nations Development Program. We also have a safeguard information system that informs how we shall respect and address the safeguards that go with the Red Plus implementation phase. Again, we have developed a national forest reference level, which is a document that informs then our current emissions scenario. And a system is already in place and currently at a completion that will support the assessment of performance of efforts within the country. The National Forest Monitoring System and the Forest Reference Level have been delivered with a strong support from the Japanese government, JICA and JAXA. And those elements are already deposited with the Forest Information System that is based at Kenya Forest Service. Moving forward, we also know that we are supposed to invest in other actions, and one of them is to provide an opportunity for an engagement of everybody, including the private sector. And as part of that, then we are organizing, we are setting up an institutional framework for implementation. We will be providing for our country a registry for approval of Red Plus activities at the project level. We will be providing for ourselves an equitable benefit sharing mechanism and a carbon monitoring system across the jurisdictions within the country. We think that with these elements and additional work that we are proposing, then we will be able to deliver a country that is ready to access climate investments and carbon finance, as we are currently discussing under Article 6.4. We've already received instructions that will provide the opportunity for us to engage and deliver a climate finance, but at the same time, we've been told to deliver our NDC that has a very strong forestry agenda. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alfred Gicho. He's also our focal point for Red Plus, national focal point for Red Plus in our country, Kenya. We want to have a continuation of this discussion by inviting Peter Sriayo to come and give a detailed technical process of what Alfred has laid the background for. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you very much. As Mr. Ndwata has mentioned, my name is Peter Sriayo, working for Kenya Forest Service. And I will be talking about the technical progress of Kenya's Red Plus. Sorry that this is not the updated presentation. Next. All right, Mr. Gicho has already mentioned that as a country, we already have these four key elements required for Red Plus readiness. Next. And next. I'll be narrowing down to the two key elements, that is the forest reference level and the national forest monitoring system. And as a country, when we are developing the forest reference level, we had to make key decisions on the forest definition, the scale, greenhouse gases, carbon pools, reference period, and the construction method. And in line with the stepwise approach, We will be improving on this, and we will be including in future other greenhouse gases and carbon pools. And at the moment, we are having what we call a project adapt impress that is helping us to improve the emission estimates. Next. The forest reference level that we set as a country was set at 52 plus a million tons of carbon dioxide per year. And it is key to note that the pilot data, the inventory data that we used, we relied on pilot data because as a country, we have not undertaken what we call a national forest inventory. Next. So for the National Forest Monitoring System, we have already developed as a country, but we have not operationalized yet. And under this particular National Forest Monitoring System, we have two key functions, the monitoring aspect and the data management function. And let me just say that as a country, we have this system. And we are not only having this system for monitoring and reporting on Red Plus activities, but for the entire forestry sector. And it really helps us in the management aspects. Next. So for the monitoring function, we are monitoring specific activities. One is the activity data, emission factor, forest cover area change, policies and measures, biodiversity and project information. At the moment, we are still populating on the same. Next. 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 So, next. So as a country for the forest cover change monitoring, we are relying on JJ First, as the first presenter had mentioned. We are among the 78 countries that are utilizing the same. And in our forest information platform, we have integrated the tool, and we are able to monitor deforestation in the country. Next. And we also have what we call the near real-time forest alert system that we rely on alerts by the use of Sentinel-2, and the alerts are sent, and then we process them and send to the field officers, who will use the Survey 123 tool to be able to report on what has actually happened on the ground. And we have certain reports, including the type of activities that are taken place and the cause of those particular activities. And as a country, we are appealing that in future, maybe we need to make some satellite data freely available, especially those ones that have radar sensors, and as well as those with high resolution. Otherwise, I thank you.
Thank you, Peter. I think you're appreciating that we have come a long way. And we are improving. And together with the elements that Alfred talked about, there we have the Red Plus strategy, and we have the safeguard information system that forms the preparedness of the country for Red Plus implementation. And the UNDP has come in handy really to stand with us in that kind of discussion and implementation. And at this juncture, I would want to call Geoffrey to come over and deliver his presentation. Welcome.
I think Kenya is now ready for investments in this area. As you have seen, we have a Red Plus strategy in place.
Forests are fundamental to regulating and stabilizing global climate. Halting and reversing deforestation and land degradation by 2030 will be a major milestone towards achieving the 2050 net zero target. Improper land use, deforestation, and degradation account for 10 to 12% of global greenhouse gas emissions. Protecting forests also comes with clear benefits for people, biodiversity, and sustainable development. In Kenya, deforestation and rangeland degradation are a major driver to biodiversity loss, depletion of water resources, and livelihood loss. It is estimated the forest and land degradation results to GDP losses of 3-5% annually and impacting heavily on the quality of livelihoods and the socio-economic fabric.
Climate change is complicating our roadmap towards socio-economic transformation and achievement of sustainable development goals. I have directed that a long-term and sustainable solution to the planetary challenges be put in place. The ultimate solution includes greening our country to more than 30% of tree cover by 2032. The central role forests play in addressing the effects of climate change has become more prominent now than ever, thanks to their unparalleled capacity to absorb, store carbon, and regulate climate.
Kenya's president recognizes the need to accelerate forestry and land restoration and is leading the country on a drive to grow 15 billion trees and restore 10.6 million hectares of degraded landscapes by 2032. This ambition will require $5 billion to be implemented over the next 10 years. The presidential program on forest and rangeland restoration will bring multiple substantial benefits in the land use sector and generate a triple win for climate, biodiversity, and landscape restoration.
So as you've seen, Kenya requires $5 billion to implement this program. UNDP is designing a tool and including blended finance to see how Kenya can be able to mobilize these resources. So we'll be working with bilateral partners, and I want at this point to appreciate the government of Japan, who've already put in some seed funding through their JSB, Joint Supplementary Budget, that has started some of the initial work towards getting this innovative fund in place. We'll also be designing a very robust private sector engagement platform. Already, we have seen some private sector players in Kenya come up and adopt forests, but we want to make this global. We want to reach out to the global private sector so that we can see how we can be able to support this initiative. We have opportunities of crowdfunding, carbon markets, engagement, green bonds, and other market-based incentive instruments and tools that are going to be designed to unlock additional funding and financing in this sector so that you can be able to meet the ambitious plans in this regard. So, but as I conclude, the UN system in Kenya is coming together. We have prepared a joint program bringing together UNEP, UNDP, FAO, and UNCDF. It's called the Sustainable Tree Growing Fund. It's going to be headquartered in New York. We want to have a truly global fund that is available so that the global community can be able to support this very ambitious initiative that Kenya is doing that will go a long way in reducing the emissions globally and also provide new stocks and new carbon sinks that can be able to make us deal with climate change. So it's to invite all of you to come into Kenya and to engage. As the president stated earlier, Kenya is now ready for business. The regulatory is in place. We have the Red Plus strategy. We have the safeguards. So we are basically ready to engage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joyfrey. I think what he has said is music to our ears, and we look forward to engaging. We have a principle of not leaving anyone behind, and even the motto of this COP27, implementing together, goes together with what he has said, and I think we are ready to engage. I think the next presenter is Wesley Jonathan. He is the project manager of IMPRES. IMPRES is a UK packed project together with the Kenya Forest Service through Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO. And I think he is going to explain how we are trying to improve our forest reference level in Kenya to make sure that it is well positioned to be able to look at the carbon financing issue through meeting the standards that have been put in place.
Hello, my name is Wesley Roberts. I'm the project manager for the IMPRES project. IMPRES is a collaboration between the Kenyan Forest Service, FAO, and is funded by UK PACT. The title of my presentation is Satellite Remote Sensing for Improving Measurements for Payments to Reduce Emissions and Strengthen Sinks in Kenya. So, what is IMPRES? At its core, IMPRES seeks to strengthen Kenya's national forest monitoring system, such that the system produces high integrity forest data. The high integrity forest data will help Kenya to respond to the technical requirements associated with novel carbon standards such as arch trees or the VCS JNR framework. By producing high integrity forest data, Kenya will then open access to carbon finance in the future. The program is being piloted in Kenya and will continue to run between 2021 and 2023. Earth observation plays an important role in improving Kenya's national forest monitoring system. And I'd like to present two examples that the program is using to improve the national forest monitoring system in Kenya. One being mangrove mapping, and the second is an improved approach to quantifying activity data. And I'd just like to say that all of the analysis makes use of open forest tools and is deployed on the CEPAL platform. So, the first example here is the mapping of mangrove forests in Kenya. Kenya's original reference level combined coastal forests and mangroves. Following a technical assessment by the UNFCCC, one of the recommendations emerging from the technical assessment was that Kenya should strive to separate coastal forests from mangroves, as the mangroves form an important component and they're a high carbon environment that Kenya should leverage to access potential emission reductions associated with activities in the mangroves. So the example here shows an RGB composite around Mombasa, as well as a tassel cap transformation of that composite. And in the tassel cap transformation, you can clearly see the difference between coastal forests and mangroves. Using this transformation, it then becomes fairly straightforward to produce a mangrove map. This mangrove map is then incorporated into Kenya's reference period and is valid for the year 2013, which is the start of Kenya's reference period. The second example is activity data. Now, activity data is key because it helps the country quantify and better understand land use change, particularly in the context of deforestation and forest loss. So in Kenya, what the program is doing is it's essentially letting computers do the tedious work of identifying where potential change is located. On the left-hand side, we have a map of Kenya showing sample locations of a high-intensity grid that is overlaid over Kenya. And for each of those locations, time series analysis is conducted using time series analysis tools that are available on CEPAL. The time series analysis tools helps to identify where potential change is located. The program then takes that potential change and puts it into a database and gives it to a team of image interpreters who then go about validating whether the change has occurred or not. The validated change is then used to quantify activity data in an updated reference level. The IMPRES project has been working very hard to get the activity data completed, and we should be seeing results sometime in December. I'd like to end off with some opportunities for potential collaboration. FAO continues to support many countries in the MRV space, and we'd like to continue that work. We'd also like to continue collaboration with data providers. JAXA's Kyoto and Carbon Initiative has supported mangrove mapping throughout the world, implemented by the Global Mangrove Alliance. FAO would be interested in hosting some of that data on the CEPAL platform, and there are definitely opportunities for FAO to collaborate with JAXA. In terms of restoration planning and monitoring, obviously Kenya has a long history of restoration planning. As part of the program, we're introducing the framework for ecosystem restoration and monitoring, or the FERM, to stakeholders in the country. And then a second tool called C-Plan, which is a tool available in CEPAL, and it facilitates restoration planning using geospatial data. And finally, obviously, capacity development is a core activity undertaken by FAO. In the near future, we'll be launching a massive open online course, or a MOOC, focusing on the CEPAL platform, highlighting the tools that are available on that platform. And we'd certainly enjoy, and we know that the program will benefit from additional collaboration with partners such as JAXA. So thank you very much. I will be available and online to answer any questions that you may have. And thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Wesley, for such an informative presentation. Would want to cross over to Asia and find out the experiences that they have as far as forestry monitoring is concerned. And I have the pleasure now to invite Dr. Berinda Arunaruati Madgono to come over and do her presentation. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. As you may aware that Indonesia already got the benefit from the RAP result-based payment for about Indonesia has recorded an approved funding award for USD 103.8 million from the Green Climate Change. GCF, and that is for RED. And for that one, actually, we have our National Forest Monitoring System that will be presented here. But it's there. I have to this one. Okay. Okay, we use this National Forest Monitoring System also for the RED Plus. Just want to have some background that our area is quite a huge area, and then it's really difficult to have the data to monitor the area. We use actually the optical landsat data for monitoring for our monitoring system, and also there are we try also to use the Sentinel-2 images. So we have 208 scene for landsat and 556 scene for the Sentinel. Just try to get the impression how complex the area. This slide is actually explaining that we have a quite strict definition related to what we call it forest definition, that is the forest cover, and also what we call it forest state. That is actually the legal definition, but this is the area that designed it for forestry purpose. They can be forested or not forested, but this is something that really important we explain, because usually for the RED Plus we have to really explain what the difference between the forest status and the forest cover itself. Using our monitoring system, actually we have several components, but here first is about the natural forest, the terrestrial measurement, so we have everything on the ground measurement. And then the second one is related to the land cover and also the forest cover establishment. And the third one is about the land cover change and also monitoring the deforestation. And the last one, that is actually what we call it devegetation. Actually, that is actually the tools that we establish, try to have the alert system for the deforestation itself. Here we have explained everything clearly during under the RED system. This is actually the terrestrial monitoring system we have. So we calculate everything with the plot. This is the distribution of our plot. It's total is about 4 million plots over the country. And we measure this one. And actually, based on this, we create our emission factor. So we have the biomass establish from here and create the emission factor from that one. And this one is actually the system that we have for the activity, because if we deal with the red plus, we deal with the monitoring the climate change, we should have two data. That is the emission factor, and the second one is the data activity. For the remote sensing, we already have the long experience having a very manual system up to now. I would say we have the six period that we already established the system. In the beginning, for the first period, we have, it's just like within 10 years, we only have two sets. But on the period two, we have like quite impressed like every 3 years. And now start from 2011, we have already yearly. The yearly information provided from the monitoring system, it's really important if we are the red country. So in this one, we also add our information, not only about the deforestation, but it's also about the fire. As you may aware that the fire is also one of the source of the emission. So we have the burn scar map. It's also yearly, start in year 2000. So this is not, so we work also with the JAXA for that one. This is just the like cover information. This is information provided in the night year. Let me show this one, because this is show how we have the monitoring system, explain the information from year 90s up to now. Let me finish this one, because this is just the last, yeah, that one. And this is just when we start also use the data from JAXA, we use Alos Pulsar and so on, but there are some problems that we have not yet continue to use this data. This is just the workshop that we already have. And I, with this one, I would like to close the presentation. Hope this gives us some valuable information. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. That is a case from Indonesia. We have a lot to learn together. We need to compare notes and see how we can improve our national forest monitoring systems for the better of our countries. Time is not with us, and I'd want to welcome a presenter from Mozambique, Mr. Makwakwa, to make his presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank the government of Kenya, JICA, JAXA, for inviting Mozambique to come and participate in this side event. So I'll be talking about National Forest Monitoring System in Mozambique. Next. Next. Okay. So I will skip this slide here. Well, just for those who are not familiar with Mozambique, I'll like to inform you that, okay, we have almost 38 million hectares with the 220,000 hectare of deforestation per year. So here, the concept of the National Forest Monitoring System, which is around around the bringing the robust transparency, national forest monitoring, according to the decision of the UNFCCC. And then, as we know, we have four keys, but I will focus only in one of those keys with the National Forest Monitoring System, which is umbrella of MRV. So when we talk about MRV, we know that it comes into bringing data to the place and being reporting it. So, but for that, we had to look the legal framework in Mozambique, starting by the National Climate Strategy, National Forest Program, National Strategy of Red Plus, and so forth. So those are the legal framework in Mozambique. And then we started our work in 2010 when we had a grant aid from JAXA. And once again, thanks to JAXA, and the, I mean, JICA. And then this grant, it led us to start to cooperate with JAXA to have satellite data of the high resolution. And then we started to do our mapping where we did our best reference forest map based on the 2013. We came down to the activity data where we used our forest collect earth. And then this, it allowed us to do our frame. After that, we had to start to carry on our National Forest Inventory. But to inform you that this inventory, it was the fourth one, starting from 98. But there was a kind of inconsistency. That's why we decided to come on board on the national reference, National Forest Monitoring System. And then we continue with our data, producing the historical data, using the new method that we've been applying. I'm talking about wall-to-wall method. And then we started to do our zoning, and then we started to be engaged with systematically with the wildfire information. And then, so we continued producing our emission reduction payment agreement that it allowed us to receive our first payment on the service environment in 2019. But there we had to establish a kind of a deforestation control where we developed a satellite-based deforestation reference system where we can have information at some real time using the JJ Fast information and also our information. So this is information we use to support our forest rangers to the quality control, the agriculture system. So for that, we had to bring the community on board, where we did a kind of a participatory deforestation monitoring, because we need community to help us to understand these, because are the one who are in the base. And then we had to do our permanent plot sampling in order to continue to measure all of this information. The most interesting things where we started to have cooperation with IT2O, where we, under conclusion, the timber tracking. So this timber tracking, I'm talking about the forest harvesting since the field, and then to track it until the last destination. But this system is linked to what we developed as our forest information platform, which aggregate all of those systems. And then this information is linked to our spatial data. So this, it makes us to start to be much more reliable in where the information is being harvested and where it goes to. So end of what we've been doing, we did a lot of activities like a piloting project and so on. So I would like to show you this map. This is one of the reference base that we're doing. And then, so you can access this information from our web page, and then you can find different information inside where the early warning system it shows, and then you can check it if you are capable. But there we have a kind of challenges. So this is the list of challenges that we have. It's not easy to get satellite data. It's not easy to have the enough human resource capable to work with remote sensing to in order to respond to the issue of BOR or BTR or national communication, even to respond to the issue of NDC. So we need a kind of support. And then in order to carry on, this is required under UNFCCC. So having said this, I want to say thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Makwakwa from Mozambique. I think we have had interesting presentations, and the time is on our side. But quickly, I would want to call the panelists in front just to take your seats here. Quickly, please. And at this juncture, Lily, I want to seek your indulgence so that I only take one question from the floor that can be reacted to by the team of presenters that is in front. Do we have some question on the floor?
Hello, this is Prabhupada Patra from Jamstek in Yokohama, Japan. So my question is for the Indonesian presentation. I am very glad to see that the time series of the forest fire biomass burning the plot time series. I'm very impressed that the biomass burning has been gone down in the recent times. So I'm basically curious, what is the main reason? Is it a climate effect? Because in recent times we have less number of El Ninos, or is it the policy at the governmental level to control the fire and control the land use changes.
Dr. Barida?
Okay, thank you for the question. Yes, it is true. For the fire itself, it is true that we first we try to have all the data ready. So meaning that everybody know that there will be somebody monitor the activity in the area. And then we have also established the policy that actually this is not only about try to stop, but we have to be ready before it happened. So there is already some communication with people on the ground. So if there is already a warning, there will be a El Nino or something, everybody on the ground is already ready. And there will be a monitoring show that they really control their area or not. That is really helpful. So they try to work intensively and in coordination on the ground to really maintain and to really guarantee that the forest will be reduced consequently. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any other question from the floor? I know this is a bit technical and sometimes grasping it quickly could be a bit difficult. We have a question? There seems we don't have a question. And I think I want to thank the panelists who have very eloquently represented the presentations here from other countries. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you so much. Welcome, Dr. Inoue.
Thank you very much, presenters and Peter, for your excellent presentation and the panel discussion. Thank you very much. So time is not enough. So now we are going to go for the closing remarks. So I would like to introduce Mr. Yutaka Kawashima. He is a director of Forest Carbon Sink Strategy Office, Forest Agency. Government of Japan. Mr. Yutaka-san, please, yes, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Inoue, for the introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, in the Article 5 of the Paris Agreement, it is said that parties should take action to conserve and enhance as appropriate sinks and reservoirs of greenhouse gas, including forest, and encourage parties to take action to implement and support RED Plus. In this seminar today, it was introduced that how Japanese Earth observation satellites contribute to improving forest monitoring and management, as well as nature-based solutions for climate change mitigation and adaptation in Africa and around the world. Then, the progress in the development of the RED Plus readiness, including National Forest Monitoring System, NFMS, which is an integration of information from Earth observation system and on-the-ground monitoring system, as well as a safeguard information system, SIS, on the social and environment factors in Kenya, Mozambique, and Indonesia were presented. In addition, new efforts to understand both sinks and sources was presented, capturing trends in photosynthetic activities and changes in CO2 concentration in forests in the African region and not being captured by conventional observations. This seminar is very useful to get to know the importance of the technical advancements in forest carbon monitoring, as well as the development of appropriate policy measures to tap into the carbon markets while achieving NDC, to contribute the global targets of climate change mitigation. In this regard, the recent RED Plus achievement of Kenya and other partner countries were shared for mutual progress. I would like to express my sincere gratitude to all the experts who have provided such great useful information today. Lastly, but not least, as a forester, I would like to introduce about the JICA Technical Cooperation in Kenya. Forestry Breeding Center of Japan and Kenya Forestry Research Institute have developed superior varieties of Meria volkensi, which has useful traits for planting plantation development in dry land of Kenya and has potential for improving livelihoods of farmers with its good timber quality. I would like to express my expectation that the satellite technology will improve not only sustainable forest management, but also sustainable wood use. Both of them enhance sinks and reservoirs of greenhouse gas through cyclic use of forest resources in Africa and around the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Director Kawashima-san, the closing, excellent closing remarks. Thank you. So this is the end of this seminar. Thank you very much for your kind attendance. So some coffees and bread provided on the right-hand side of this venue. So if you are hungry, getting hungry, you can stop by to have it and exchange some interactions and networking. So thank you very much. So please clap the last applause to the all presenters. Thank you very much. See you again. Okay.